Hello and welcome back to Kong API Summit 2025. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the Practice Lead and Principal Analyst at theCUBE Research, focused on application development and application modernization and everything that has to do with developers and application and modernization. And today I'm coming to you live from the show floor of the event. I'm joined by Rishi. Rishi, how are you doing?
I'm doing absolutely fabulous, Paul. It's like the second day for the summit and I'm enjoying it so far, yeah.
Great to have you on theCUBE. Why don't you tell the audience a little bit about yourself, a little bit about Capgemini?
Yeah, so I lead the cloud native, practice, and then it was delivery for all of, financial services based out of Chicago, yeah.
Nice, yeah, I mean, this is the best place to be at that, because this is all the stuff that's happening here is around cloud native development and such. I liked our discussion we were having before we got on live here. Mm-hmm. We were talking about the growth of environments and how organizations are moving. In my practice, I focus on past, present, future, like how applications are modernizing and such. And I look at heritage applications, and those heritage applications, sometimes people call them legacy, but sometimes people don't like those words, right?
Yeah.
So in the cloud world, we like to use that heritage world to kind of harmonize. But one of the things I like to, talk about is, Capgem has over 200 certified Kong professionals.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot. So you act as a service provider, a service delivery partner for your organizations working in these spaces. So regardless of where organizations are in their own journey, whether if they're early starting their modernization or if they're like fully mature, you have them covered. Is that true?
That's true. And I think, as I said, and it's good that you call them as heritage and not legacy, because a lot of them, they are still have their most critical workloads running on those, right? Whether you call it MuleSoft, or you call it, DataPower, or now the most, advanced version of DataPower, which is the IBM Epic, right? So a lot of them, they are trying to modernize that whole space, and now with AI coming to the fold, and the Agentic AI, right? So they want to get that whole middleware, layer correct.
Yeah.
Because anything which they can even want to do in terms of Agentic AI, the underlying API should be, it should be very well structured and well formed and well defined. So they are just trying to address that space, right? And so that's more of a, newer use case for Agentic AI, but, a lot of them, they're still trying to solve the traditional problems with the, with all of their legacy integration, right? And I will use the word legacy.
No, it's fair. It's a fair point. I mean, there's a lot of times these organizations are really trying to get off their legacy environments because of a variety of different reasons, right? But a lot of times these organizations will run into skill gap issues, skill challenges, right?
Mm-hmm.
Their current staff doesn't have the ability to move because they just don't know it. They have to up level and move faster. That's where Capgem can come in, right? Capgem can come in, you're well versed in Kong, you're well versed in these APIs, you can harmonize the connectivity, especially when you think about some of the tech stack that was announced here, like the MCP servers, the agents, the machine-to-machine connectivity. That's important. And would you agree that's what your clients are looking for?
Yeah, so I think, all of these standards, whether you call it MCP or A2A or even the LangChain agent model, these are important and these are, the basis of the whole agentic AI. Even though I believe that, the MCP protocol itself, while it is open source and there is a lot of attraction in terms of how you can use it, it's not production ready yet. There are a lot of security gaps or vulnerabilities around this. So, that's where, all of our clients, they're trying to see how they can make use of these agentic workflows, right? So I would say, this MCP, A2A, all of these protocols, they are still there, and I see there'll be a lot more, specifications coming for data privacy, which will evolve over a period of time. But to build all of this, I think all you need is underlying part of all of this is APIs, right? So I think that's where I would say, in order to get to an agentic AI, you certainly need a very well-formed and well-defined API layer.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think that you have to harmonize them, the APIs, in order to have the connectivity to the data sources behind it.
Mm.
But from your vantage point, what do you see is the largest challenge enterprises run into from your perspective?
So I would say, you know, before they can even think of agentic AI, I would say, you know, they still have to do a lot of, I would say, a combination of, you know, modernizing their entire middleware stack, and that could be anywhere from, you know, rationalizing a set of old school ESBs, you know, like the likes of DataPower, web methods, you know, and then they have a bunch of these, what you termed as the heritage ones, right? So likes of IBM APIC, your MuleSoft, or even, you know, in some cases, even WSO2 or Apigee. So they're using all of this in a very federated way. So they need to rationalize all of that and have a very standard middleware layer. And on top of that, they need to, you know, also rationalize the set of services, right? Because right now, if you go to any large enterprise and you say, do you have a catalog which can define all of your business capabilities and what are the underlying services they are running on? I think 90% the answer would be no. So I believe they should certainly invest in rationalizing all of that, because the moment you bring in agentic AI, that problem is going to compound, because AI won't be, if it doesn't have the right kind of, you know, mapping to your actual services, it might go haywire.
Yeah, I hear you. You know, and that's one of the things that's why a lot of organizations are kind of a little bit shy at just starting and going in a direction, because they're not sure if that's the right direction.
Exactly.
But you know, your organization you've created accelerators built on top of comp.
Yeah.
Right? And specifically around modernization, right?
Yep.
What kind of measurements do you put in place to kind of drive this?
That's a good question. So, well, you know, I can talk a lot about technical measurements, but I believe, you know, there are a lot of business KPIs which we try to, you know, tell based on, you know, the actual problem which you're trying to solve. So whether it is a time to market or time to launch new features, new product, right? Or is it just basically, it could be as good as being able to do releases every 2 weeks, right? So I think it's a combination of all of that. But I would say, depending upon, like for a insurance company, it'll be, you know, how good is their overall, you know, claims handling thing, right?
Sure.
Or how good is their overall, you know, premium audit, right? And what goes underneath a premium audit system or a claims handling system is where, if you modernize your underlying core system, if it does that, is all the technical, you know, KPIs. But I think from a business perspective, it's basically, you know, how much agility you have in your business, and, you know, and then business agility could be again broken up based on the domain you are in, but I would say those would be the actual business KPIs we try to, you know, stick to whenever we are trying to do any of these large scale.
I think that's smart. I think those KPIs make sense. What advice would you give the audience around, you know, people that are reluctant to get started, even though they know they need to?
Yeah.
I mean, what we're finding in our research, we're finding that 25% of IT budget is allocated to AI-based projects, but yet those AI-based projects are undefined.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't know what to do with it,
yeah.
Right? And so it's this use it or lose it, but then there's also an edict down from either the board or the CEO or the company itself saying, hey, you need to move in this direction. So CIOs are sitting there going, I need to figure out what to do.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you advise somebody on that?
I would say it'll be a mix of, you know, first trying to get your core building blocks straight, right? Which, as I said, you know, trying to standardize your set of services, the actual business capabilities, trying to standardize your core middleware, you know, integration architecture. And then I would say start small, right? I think if you're in, like, I'll just give a few examples which can come up. Like for an insurance company, you know, it could be as simple as, you know, how can I reduce my overall premium audit leakage, right? I'm just making a, so just take that business flow,
yep,
and see how can you possibly, you know, where all you need, which all actors, whether it is on the business side or all on the IT side, and if you have to orchestrate that entire workflow and automate it, what are the different possibilities at this point of time, right? And that could be a combination of making use of any of these, you know, agent-based frameworks, trying to interact with a lot of LLMs, right? And then try to identify the correct LLM for the purpose, And then, of course, trying to have the right set of guardrails wherever you need a human in the loop to, you know, to identify the efficacy of the actual output given by the AI. Just try it as one simple business use case,
yeah,
and then see whether you, the investment which you have done in your underlying services, business capabilities, whether those are good enough. And I think once you're able to prove out that one business use case with, you know, with a set of, say, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, maximum 10 agents, then you know that, okay, you have ticked out all of the, you know, basics for making an agentic workflow. And then you can think of, okay, now I need to scale. But I believe there is a lot more before you can achieve that. Like as I said, you know, and the MCP protocol itself has a lot of security vulnerabilities in it. So nothing is, in my view, currently is ready yet for production, right? So, and this space is going to evolve. Right now, you can make use of MCP along with third-party tools to address the vulnerability gap, and you can still come up with, you know, actual workflows which is production ready.
Yeah.
But they have to invest time in doing that.
Of course, of course. You know, and this is also coming from a place where of experience, right?
Yeah.
Capgem won the strategic partnership award, you know, of excellence, partnership excellence at Kong API Partner Awards. That recently, that's really cool. So, but if I think about like looking forward, everything you just said, how do you see Capgem and Kong, really the partnership evolving to meet the needs of the enterprises in that next wave of digital and AI kind of focused environments?
Yeah, so that's, I think that's exactly was everything yesterday is what we discussed. But just to, you know, double click on that, we are currently, you know, seeing three kinds of engagements, right? One is migration from all of these heritage, you know, legacy ESBs into the, you know, into Kong, right?
Yeah.
The second is they want to basically just greenfield feature development, which is a bunch of custom cloud native apps where, you know, API becomes the, you know, the core basis. And the third is basically more, I would say, reducing their overall technical debt, right? Mm-hmm. So now, and the fourth, if I have to add one more, which so far we haven't seen, but I think we foresee that that's where clients will come in, and some of the clients who are trying to be the front runners in that, they're trying to embrace the whole agentic AI workflow. So that piece so far has not come up yet, but we are trying to, you know, build capabilities and accelerators in all of these four areas, right? So the one for which we got awarded is was actually for the first use case where we are able to accelerate moving up from heritage, you know, tools onto Kong. And that whole thing is all Gen AI enabled. It's not agentic yet, it's Gen AI enabled.
Yeah.
Same thing, we want to do it for, you know, for your regular, you know, greenfield development and also for your tech debt. In fact, we have developed something, you know, address the tech debt part. And then the fourth use case is mostly to realize the agentic workflow. We are working together with them. We are trying to understand what is their AI, you know, gateway capability. How are they handling this whole LLM proxy layer? What are the ways in which they're trying to, you know, address the actual security vulnerability of MCP servers?
Sure.
And then we are trying to see, okay, how we can leverage that just to, you know, build on top of the eventing and the API gateway as one unified platform. So, yeah.
Yeah, Rishi, this has been great. It sounds like you have a plan, you have a method to the madness of trying to put it in all this together. Rishi, thank you for being on theCUBE today. This has been great. Your insights have really been impactful. I think it really is powerful to help the organizations get going. So thank you for being on.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And it was nice. And I enjoy the rest of your conference. Thank you.
Thank you. You too. You too. I am Paul Nashawaty, and I'm coming to you live from the show floor at Kong API Summit 2025 on theCUBE, your leading source of tech news.